Hi, good evening everyone. And today's discussion session is going to be on pressure sores. I think it's quite a common problem, and it's difficult to manage it because the treatment as such, the surgical treatment as such, is quite simple to understand. The surgical steps are quite simple to understand and quite simple to execute, but we all know that we do not get good results most of the time in pressure sore surgery because of the underlying problems. So today's session, I'll talk about the surgical treatment and the medical treatment, of course, of pressure sores, but I'm going to concentrate on the cause of it and how to prevent the causes and how to rectify the problems that occur with the basic understanding of the pressure sores. I'll share my screen now. Yeah. So today it's going to be pressure sores and their management, and of course the quiz question of the day. Now, pressure ulcers have been called various terms: decubitus ulcer, bed sore, and pressure sore. The decubitus ulcers have been called so because they derive from the Latin word decumbere, which means to lie down. And it occurs over the areas that have underlying bony prominences when their subject is recumbent. That is the sacrum, the trochanter, the heel, and the occiput. But pressure ulcers are not just from lying down. You get pressure ulcers from different positions of rest. Like for instance, when the patient is sitting up with 90 degree bed elevation, head end elevation. We do this a lot of times. You know, this is one of the most common irritant factors that lead to the formation of pressure sore. You would have seen, you yourself would have seen in the ICU when the patient is made to sit up, patient is lying down, and the nurse or the worker, they rise up the head end of the bed and the patient just sags down in the bed. That is one of the most uncomfortable positions and one of the commonest reasons why pressure sores develop. It's a very innocuous movement that is done. You are doing it with a good intention. But that is one of the reasons why we'll see how that happens. So when the patient is in that position, the main force is on the ischial tuberosity and the sacrum, and of course the spinous process and the heels. When the patient is totally supine, the pressure is on the heels, the sacrum, the elbows, the scapulae, and the back of the head. When the patient is lying in the right lateral or the left lateral position, the malleoli are involved. Then the knees, medial and lateral condyles, the greater trochanter is now involved, the ischium involved, the shoulder, acromion process, the ear, and the side of the head also can be involved. Then when the patient is prone, the problem is when we see a patient with the sacral pressure, we ask them to lie down in prone position. This is also dangerous because you can develop pressure sores on the toes, knees, genitals, breasts in women, acromial process, and cheek and ear. And even when the patient is wheelchair bound, you can get pressure sores in the shoulder blade and in the coccygeal region and in the back of the knee and the foot. So with all these, we need to understand how this pressure sore, we all understand that the pressure is a big problem, but it is one of the problems. There are so many other problems, and pressure by itself is not very very bad. We'll see how that happens. There are three important factors for a pressure sore or a pressure ulcer to develop. The three important factors are pressure, as we have seen, the name itself suggests. Second is friction, and the third is shear. How many of you have been able to understand what is this friction, what is this shear? To understand, because this is the basis for understanding how pressure sores develop. Now, first we'll take up pressure. Pressure is defined as the amount of force applied perpendicular to surface per unit area of application. Very simple. The amount of pressure that I'm applying over a particular area at right angles. So this is when I press it like this, I'm applying pressure over my hand. So this is the pressure. A force applied over a small area will produce greater pressure effect then the same force applied over a larger area. Obvious. So if the pressure, the same pressure is going to be applied over a larger area, the pressure distribution will be equal and you will not have greater pressure in one particular area. Whereas if the same pressure is applied over a small area, that pressure will be much more. So this pressure is measured as the unit of force is the Newton. So the unit of pressure is Newtons per square meter. Force per square area, which is force per square meter, which is either Newtons per square meter or Pascals. It can also be measured in millimeters of mercury. So this is pressure. We've understood what is pressure. It is a perpendicular amount of force being applied to a particular area. Now, when you apply force to a particular area, what happens to the underlying tissues? The underlying tissues are all very soft and pliable. So what happens when you apply? Now look at this diagram. This is the bone and the pressure is going to be applied from here. So what happens? It doesn't completely compress like that. There is some change in the, now this is the lines of the tissue, right? So when pressure is applied on this area, equal pressure is applied, the pressure over this area is more because the bone is here, it receives more of the pressure and there is a compression stress here. On the side, there is a tensile stress and on this side, there is a shear stress. We'll see what is the shear now. So pressure is not just the pressure. I told you just applying pressure here. I have applied pressure, but the changes that occur inside the body are different. You have got shear stress, you have got tensile stress, you have got compression stress. Now, in 1930, Landis found that the average capillary closing pressure is approximately 32 millimeters of mercury. Now, when with the subject supine, the points of high pressure, the sacrum, buttocks, they are subject to pressures of roughly 50 to 60 millimeters of mercury. And when sitting, pressures up to 100 millimeters of mercury were recorded over the ischial tuberosities. So this is approximately the measure of, now I told you can measure it in Pascals or Newton per square meter or in millimeters of mercury. So it could be anywhere from 30 to 100 millimeters of mercury. Now, is this pressure enough to cause a pressure ulcer? Now, the effects, what happens when this pressure is applied? What happens to the blood vessels? Because that is the main reason why these ulcers develop, why there is ischemia. Shear stresses can reduce or prevent blood flow through many mechanisms. So when you apply a force, the changes that occur inside are causing certain changes. First is direct compression and occlusion of the blood vessels. Second is stretching and narrowing of the dermal capillary beds. And thirdly, bending and pinching of the blood vessels running perpendicular to the skin surface. So the direct compression of the vessels, stretching and narrowing of the capillary beds, and bending and pinching of the blood vessels running perpendicular to the skin surface. So when all this happens, obviously there is a change or a reduction in the blood supply that leads to certain changes. So these are the pressures that have been recorded different positions in different positions of the patient. For instance, supine position, we told you the sacral region, the posterior calf region and the heel region. Here, the back and the occiput. When the patient is lying prone on the chest abdominal region, and then on the knees, the front of the knees, and then the lower aspect of the anterior leg. Similarly, when the patient is sitting with the feet hanging down freely, the pressure is equally distributed. But when the patient is sitting with the feet supported on a stand, the pressure is more in the ischial region. Now, it is not just the pressure that is going to cause a problem. There is also an influence of the duration of the pressure. So it has been found that the pressure roughly doubles the capillary closing pressure applied for 2 hours, resulting in irreversible ischemic damage to the tissue. So if you're going to apply the same pressure for just 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, at 2 hours, there is a doubling of the capillary closing pressure. So if damaging levels of pressure are applied, Initially, the skin appears pale because of reduced blood flow and inadequate oxygenation, ischemia. We all saw that. We saw that the complete blood vessel can be occluded, or the capillary blood flow can be occluded, or there may be a bending or pinching of the blood vessel which is passing perpendicular to the skin. So what happens because of that? Initially, it becomes pale. And then that pallor, if you press on it, there will be a blanching. So that is very important. When the pressure is relieved, the skin quickly becomes red due to physiological response called reactive hyperemia. If the ischemia has been sufficiently short-lived, the blood flow and skin return will eventually come back to normal. If it has been sufficiently short-lived. What is sufficiently short-lived? We have seen that a study has shown that if you apply the pressure for 2 hours, then it's going to cause irreversible ischemia. There's going to be a doubling of the capillary closing pressure. More prolonged ischemia can cause blood cells to aggregate and block capillaries, perpetuating the ischemia. So now the process of ischemia has begun. So they have found out there's a relationship between the amount of pressure, the duration of application of pressure, the development of tissue damage. And this has been found in canine and rat experiments. So microscopic pathologic changes were not noted in tissues subjected to as little, were noted in tissues subjected to as little as 60 millimeters of mercury for only 1 hour. So now it's changing. The equations are changing. Pressure, yes, will cause problem. How long the pressure will cause problem? So as less as 60 millimeters of mercury for 1 hour can cause changes. So pressure by itself cannot cause any changes unless it is applied for a longer duration of time. Even if applied for a shorter duration of time, if there are other factors like intrinsic factors such as poor nutrition or concomitant problems or dry skin or extrinsic factors like shear and friction or incontinence, you can develop a pressure even at lower pressure and lower duration of the pressure. So far we have seen about the pressure component of pressure ulcers. The ability of pressure to cause tissue damage is related to duration of application and intensity of the pressure applied. And the pressure on the skin has been shown to produce greater reduction in blood flow in deep artery than skin capillaries. Now that is very significant. The changes that occur, that is the ischemia that is caused, is not only in the skin capillaries. I told you even the deep blood vessels are occluded. So the change has been shown to be causing more reduction in the deeper blood vessels than the superficial capillaries. Now there is one thing to understand here. If the superficial capillaries are involved and there is a reduction of blood flow in the superficial capillaries, that area of skin will necrose. Obviously, it will go in for ischemia. There will be a lesser tissue oxygenation and it will go in for necrosis. Whereas if the deeper vessels are involved, all the muscles, the bone, all the tissues supplied by the deeper vessels will also undergo ischemia. So what is happening, what we thought is occurring on the superficial level is actually happening at a much bigger scale in the deeper level. Now let us keep this in mind. And when the pressure is applied over a bony prominence, the internal stresses are highest in the soft tissues closest to the bony prominence. Now that makes it even more clear. When you apply pressure on the skin over a bony prominence, the changes that occur are more in the soft tissues close to the bony prominence, not on the skin. And patients at the highest risk from pressure are those who are unable to move themselves, or who have to be asked to be moved. Now, we have seen pressure. We'll come to the second force, that is friction. Friction is the force resulting relative motion, resisting relative motion between two surfaces is the precursor to shear. It develops between the patient's skin and any number of contact surfaces like patient's bedding, transfer devices, sheets, rollers, various appliance, orthotics, mobility. So, friction is the force between the patient's skin and the outside surface. It could be the bed, it could be the stretcher, it could be the orthotics, it could be the splint that is applied, whatever, skin, between the skin and the outside surface is called the friction. So friction injury will be visible. So if the patient is having friction, you can make out some sort of abrasion may be there. There may be a skin redness. All these are because of friction. And you can see that effect of the friction. Friction, however, is not the primary factor in development of pressure ulcer. Just because you have a friction, a pressure ulcer will not develop. However, this friction can indirectly lead to the formation of pressure ulcers. How? One, by stripping the epidermal layer of the skin and creating a conducive environment for ulceration and ischemia. Secondly, an alteration in the coefficient of friction increases the skin's adherence to the outer surface. Now, just imagine the patient is lying on the bed and he is being moved. For instance, I say, we'll move him like this. He moves like it. He has to come up. He's sliding down the bed. Pull him up. So now the skin is moving, abrading, undergoing friction with the bed clothes and the bed sheet. So what happens? The skin is abraded. When this skin is abraded, it will stick to the rubber sheet. Usually we put the patients on a Macintosh or a rubber sheet. So it sticks to it. Now this sticking or the adherence to the outer surface, skin's adherence to the outer surface is going to cause a big problem in the next step. So friction, the injury will be visible. It is between the skin and the contact surface. But it is not a primary factor in causing pressure ulcers. It causes it indirectly by one, weakening the skin. No? It causes an abrasion or a mild injuries. So you can see the effect of friction. And because of this, there is an increased coefficient of friction. So it sticks. You would have seen sometimes, you know, when you ask the patient to turn, you'll find that the sheet, rubber sheet, is sticking to the patient's back and sacral region. You'll have to peel it off. Okay. So that is, remember that when the next step. Now we come to shear. This is one of the, along with pressure, the shear is the most important factor causing pressure necrosis. Shear develops when friction adheres skin and superficial tissues to the sheets or bedding. We saw that. We saw why? Because of friction, the skin is adhering to the underlying bed, which then stretch tightly over the deeper structures. Underlying blood vessels are then stretched, angulated, and injured. So now the skin is stuck to the bed and the body is moving. So what happens? The skin is made immobile by the sticking to the bed, underlying bed. When the body moves, the bone also moves along with the tissue. So what happens? The tissues are moving inside. The tissues are being crushed and moved inside. So that is called shear. So patient transfers or sliding or dragging the patient in bed or boosting the patients up in bed. You know, I told you that when we started off, when you say head and elevation of the bed, immediately we elevate the bed in the ICU and patient slides down. When the patient slides down, the skin is stuck to the bed and the patient's body alone moves. The skin and of the back is still stuck. So this causes a shear inside. Okay. So shear is a mechanical force that acts on the skin in a direction parallel to the body surface. Remember, pressure is perpendicular to the body surface. Shear is parallel to the body surface. So now just think of this as pulling the bones of the pelvis in one direction and the skin in the opposite direction. Okay. You're pulling the bones and you're pulling the skin in this direction. So imagine what happens. What is happening to the intervening tissues? The deeper fascia slides downward with the bone. The superficial fascia remains attached to the dermis. This insult and causes a compromise to the blood supply, creates ischemia, leading to cellular death and tissue necrosis. Shear injury will not be seen at the skin level because it happens underneath the skin. Remember, friction, you can see it on the skin. It is happening outside the skin. Shear injury is happening inside the skin and you cannot see the changes with your naked eye. It is occurring under the skin. So this is the example I was telling you. Shear injury will not be seen at the skin level because it happens, like for instance, in the when you are pulling the patient up on a head end elevation. So there are two main forces acting. One is the perpendicular force called pressure. Second is the parallel force, tangential force called shear. So these two forces are the main forces that cause pressure ulcers. The friction is adding to the problems. So friction is not the primary cause of pressure ulcer formation. It only adds to the problems and makes it worse. So the risks from shear and friction are more in particular patients, those who require head of the bed elevation. This is very common. We have all seen it, as I said. And the second is with damp or damaged skin. We'll see that. When the skin is like that, it is even more prone for changes in friction. And because of the change in friction, more amount of shear. And because more amount of shear, more amount of damage. And third is who are difficult to reposition. Very obese patients. Patients who are undergoing spasticity. These patients are difficult to reposition. Those changes, those patients will have more risks from shear and friction. So to summarize shear and friction, we have seen pressure, and we have seen the pressure is a perpendicular force, and we have seen that pressure is causes changes not only in the blood vessels but also in the deeper tissues. As far as shear and friction are concerned, it is not possible to have shear without friction. Without friction, the tissues will not move like that. You cannot hold the skin down and move the body. It happens because of friction. But it is possible to have friction without shear. Very superficial. We all have friction burns when we fall down. No shear is occurring. It's a very little shear that is occurring. It is only the friction. So it is possible to have friction without shear. But it is not possible to have shear without friction. And shear is the result of combination of friction and gravity. It can be avoided by keeping the head of the patient bed at a lower angle. So when we raise the head end of the bed, the patient gradually slides down. When he's sliding down, the skin is already stuck. So it is only his body and his skeleton that is moving down. And so there is a shear between the patient's soft tissues and skeleton and the skin which is attached to the, which is stuck to the bed. So if gravity were not there, this will not happen. This will not happen, obviously. So that, I hope now you are clear about shear and friction. Now we need to understand this tip of the iceberg. We all say, always say that the pressure sore that you're seeing is the tip of the iceberg. Now this is the tip of the iceberg that we are seeing. But what is inside is so much. So how does it relate to the pressure sore? If you look at the pressure sore, this is how it is. Okay, what you're seeing outside is a small opening where you see an ulcer. But what is happening inside is big involvement of the bone. So it is like an inverted cone. So this is what is called the tip of the iceberg phenomena. Now we will understand this tip of the iceberg phenomena. But please remember why does it occur like this? Why is it that the skin involvement is less? Why is it that the bone involvement is more? I told you there are two reasons mainly. One is when there is a shear and a pressure, the damage to the soft tissues closer to the bone are more. Secondly, the pressure causes a problem of vascularity, not mainly in the capillaries of the skin, but in the deeper vessels supplying the deeper tissues. So more amount of ischemia is occurring without our being able to see it. Whereas if it had been involving only the skin, we would have been able to see it beautifully. But here we cannot see it. It is occurring inside. So whenever you see a pressure ulcer, remember what you're seeing is only the tip of the iceberg. Now let us see. This is just a diagrammatic representation to show. Now this is the sacral region. If you see a sacral ulcer like this, what has happened is actually the involvement is much more. It goes all around. The involvement is still there, right? Now, if you look at a cross section, this will be the edges of the skin, that is the ulcer. This is the bony prominence underneath, and the amount of necrosis will come like that. all these tissues are damaged and the superficial portion of the bone is also damaged. Okay, now this is what is called the tip of the iceberg. What you are seeing is a small ulcer. That is the ulcer that you are seeing. But they look at the amount of involvement. So whenever you see a pressure sore, if you are able to imagine this picture, you will get your treatment correct. And it is very difficult to treat it correctly unless you understand how it occurs, why it occurs. Because if you don't understand why it occurs, you are going to keep repeating the same. You can put a skin graft, you can put a flap on this. Without following the principles of pressure sore management, without understanding what has actually happened inside, by doing a flap, they're going to fail miserably. So what are the risk factors that we need to see? There are many risk factors. We have already seen pressure, friction, and shear. There are three more risk factors. Moisture. Moisture, we already mentioned that moisture is going to add a further worsening effect on the skin. So the skin is more subject to the changes caused by pressure and shear if it is going to be moist. Malnutrition. And thirdly, neurological injury. Patient is not able to move. We told you when the patient is not able to move on his own, it is going to be a further detrimental to the patient. There are multiple assessment scales for assessing. Now, if a patient is lying there in the ICU, you're called to see the patient with a pressure sore, or you have got a patient admitted in your ICU or in your ward with a problem. So you need to assess the risk of developing a pressure sore. There are multiple scores, but we will see one important scoring system called the Braden scoring system. Now, we talked about moisture. Now, moisture has got a higher coefficient of friction and more prone to maceration and excoriation. We all know this. Now, the main cause of increased moisture is urinary and fecal incontinence is the main cause, especially in patients with spinal injury. In these patients, you're going to have a fecal incontinence and urinary incontinence if they're not taken care of. This will lead to maceration of the skin, especially if the patient is lying down, the sacral skin is going to be macerated. We all know that when the skin is macerated, more changes of shear and force pressure are going to occur. So definitely is going to develop a sacral pressure sore. Now, incontinence is common in the elderly. It causes excess moisture. That's not the only reason. It also negates the acidic pH of the skin. Normally, the pH of the skin is slightly acidic. So here what happens, because of contamination with urine, there is the introduction of nitrogen derivatives. It becomes alkaline. When the skin's pH is changed, it is more amenable to damage. Fecal contamination is going to add to the problems by introducing a large bacterial load, allowing infection to set in. Moisture is, if it is excessively moist, it's not the only problem that you're going to encounter. Even excessively dry skin can cause a problem because it will be prone to cracking. It has got a decreased tensile strength. It has got reduced lipid content and impaired barrier function. So it is an independent risk factor for pressure ulceration. Moisture is an independent factor. Now, as I said, we'll be seeing the Braden scale to see what are all the factors. How do we assess a patient? A patient has been admitted with us. We need to see whether he is at high risk or lesser risk of developing a pressure sore. Evidence-based tool developed by Nancy Braden and Barbara Bergstrom that predicts the risk for developing a hospital or facility acquired pressure ulcer or injury. Now, the Braden score uses a score from less than or equal to 9 or as higher than 20, as high as 23. This is the score, 9 or up to 23. The lower the number, the higher the risk for developing an acquired ulcer or injury. 19 to 23, no risk. 15 to 18, mild risk. 13 to 14 is moderate, less than 12, severe risk. So if you have a patient, if you quantify him under the Braden scale and find that he is less than 12, understand that he is at a very high risk of developing a pressure sore. You need to take the measures that we shall be talking about. They are preventive measures that we will be talking about. Now, what is the Braden scale? What does it measure? How is the scoring done? There are six categories within the Braden scale. Sensory perception, moisture. We know moisture is important. Activity, mobility, nutrition, friction. We'll see what these are. Now, according to the sensory perception, ability to respond meaningfully to pressure-related discomfort. If the patient has sensory perception completely limited, he does not move at all, or very limited, slightly limited, no impact. So he is able to change. When he finds that when we all lie down for a long time in the same position, we automatically change. That is because of the sensory perception that we are getting, we immediately change. Whereas some patients with a score of 1 in this, they are unresponsive. They do not moan or grasp, nothing to painful stimuli due to diminished level of consciousness or limited ability to feel pain over the most of the body. So this is the first, sensory perception. Second, moisture. Constantly moist, rarely moist. If it is constantly moist, almost constantly by perspiration, urine, dampness detected every time the patient is moved or turned. Some patients sweat a lot. Even those patients, they may not have urinary incontinence, but some patients you would have seen sweat a lot, you know. So even that is a bad factor because it will get stuck to the bed, and the cause of shear is the probability of shear occurring is more. So the second is moisture. Third is activity. Is the patient confined to bed, or is it confined to the chair, or walks occasionally or walks frequently? So degree of physical activity will also help us. Next, the mobility. Completely immobile, limited, very limited, slightly limited, low, no limits in the mobility. So here you are assessing the ability to change and control position, body position. You ask the patient, please turn this side, please turn that side. He is not able to move at all. So then it becomes a high risk. Nutrition. So this also is assessed, very poor nutrition or excellent nutrition. Friction and shear. Now, how do we assess friction and shear? The problem is either there is a problem or a potential problem or no problem. We'll just see what this problem is. It requires moderate to maximum assistance in moving. Okay, so complete lifting without sliding against the sheets is impossible. See, when you want to turn a patient, you have to drag the patient over like that. When you want to turn him like that, that dragging is going to cause a problem. Sometimes what happens when you do that, the patient himself, his muscle tone is there. It will help you, for instance. You will not find it so difficult to turn the patient because patient himself is making an attempt. Some patients cannot do that because they're due to the problem in their muscle system. So there, those patients, you have to completely move them or cause a sliding against the sheets. And frequently they slide down in the bed or chair. So you have to reposition them with maximum assistance. Spasticity, contractures, agitation leads almost constant friction is there because, for instance, they are having spasticity. You're going to have friction all the time. So these patients are a problem. So now you've seen how the Braden scale is done, scoring is done. And with that, you'll be able to find out whether your patient is at risk. So now, when the pressure ulcer starts, you need to classify it. Sometimes you may be called upon to see a patient with a pressure ulcer. You need to classify it for the simple reason that your treatment is going to change according to the stage. The NPUAP, that is the National Pressure Ulcer Advisory Panel, this gave the staging system in 2007, which is a modification of the Shia's original classification. There are 4 stages plus 2 extra stages. Stage 1 is intact skin with non-blanchable redness of a localized area, usually over a bony prominence, not necessarily in the sacral region. Darkly pigmented skin may not have visible blanching. Its color may differ from the surrounding area. You may not have a typical blanching with a dark pigmented skin, but you can definitely make out a difference from the surrounding area. So intact skin with non-blanchable redness, you press it, there is no blanching at all. That is stage 1. Stage 2 is partial thickness loss, okay? Presenting as a shallow open ulcer with a pink wound without slough. Okay, now this may also present as an intact or open ruptured serum filled blister. You may have a blistering formation, blister formation. So that is stage two. It is involving the dermis. Partial dermis loss is present. Whenever you have an involvement of the dermis, you always have a blister formation, like in second degree burns. Okay, you have a blister formation. So this is the stage two. Stage three is full thickness tissue loss. So subcutaneous start may be visible, but bone, tendon, or muscle is not exposed. Slough may be present, but does not obscure the depth of the tissue loss and may include undermining and tunneling. So this can also be there, but there is full thickness loss, but bone is not involved. So tissues are lost. Only the soft tissues are involved. But the bone is not exposed. So there is no involvement of the bone. Stage four is full thickness tissue loss with exposed bone, tendon, or muscle. Exposed bone is sufficient, but not necessary to define a stage four pressure sore. If bone alone is involved, yes, it's enough. It becomes stage four. But it is not necessary because you can even have muscle involved. Now, slough or eschar may be present on the some parts of the wound. Now, it often includes undermining or tunneling. We'll see what this undermining or tunneling is. Suspected. Now, the next stage is suspected deep tissue injury. So, we have seen stage 1, 2, 3, 4. Stage 1 is just involvement of the skin and blanching or unblanchable erythema. Second is blister formation. Third is full thickness without bone exposure. Fourth is up to bone is involved. Now, this is suspected deep tissue injury, purple or maroon, localized of discolored intact skin, localized area of discolored intact skin, or filled blister due to damage of the underlying soft tissue from a pressure or shear. Now, this it is suspected deep tissue injury. The wound may evolve and become, it's not very clear. Okay, because here there is no exposure of the underlying tissues, but it is involved. The tissues are involved. So it may be painful, firm, mushy, boggy, warmer, cooler compared to the adjacent tissue. So you suspect a deeper tissue injury. There is no ulceration there up to the exposure of bone. If there had been ulceration with the exposure of the bone, you would have said stage 4. Here, there is involvement of the tissue, involvement of the deep tissue, but you cannot make out the bone. It doesn't mean that it is not a deep tissue injury because it is a suspected deep tissue injury. It's otherwise classified as I. The next is J, unstageable. Full thickness tissue loss in which the base of the ulcer is covered with slough or eschar in the wound bed. So unless the base of the wound is exposed, the true depth and therefore stage cannot be determined. So if you are called to see a patient with a pressure ulcer and you find an eschar over there, you cannot say what stage it is because you are not able to see the wound bed. It may be stage 3, it may be stage 4. So you cannot make out. So this is the J stage. So you've got four stages. And then I stage, which is suspected deep tissue injury, and you've got the J stage, which is unstageable. Now, after all this involvement, you may have involvement of the bone also. That is a big problem because skin and tissues, you can see the involvement, but the bone, you cannot make out the osteomyelitis if there is osteomyelitis. So there, what will help us? White blood cell count, ESR, and a two-view X-ray. Yes, it will help to a certain extent. Will bone scans help us? They are expensive and not very sensitive. Can we do a needle bone biopsy, Jamshedi needle bone biopsy? It has got a sensitivity of 73% and specificity of 96%. MRI overall accuracy of 97%. So, when you suspect an osteomyelitis of the underlying bone, which is most probably there, if the bone is exposed, if it has been exposed for a very long time, most probably there is osteomyelitis. However, if you want to prove that there is osteomyelitis, the best way is the non-specific findings like white blood cell count, ESR, and X-ray are good. But a bone biopsy is the more. Remember last week when we talked about wound, we said you need to do a biopsy, not a swab. You need to do a biopsy to get a good quantitative analysis of the bacterial count in the tissue. So if it is a bone involvement, you need to do a biopsy to get a good finding of bacterial infection to prove your diagnosis. So now we have seen the pressure ulcer, we have understood how it is formed, and we have understood why it occurs, we have understood the risk, patients who are at risk of developing it. Now we need to treat the patient. Obviously, we know that the causes of pressure ulcer, we have understood the causes. So now we need to treat the causes one by one. Very simple. Pressure relief, spasticity control, infection control, nutritional support, skin care, wound care. So when we write, when we see a patient with a pressure sore, before we write, give a flap cover or put a skin graft or do a debridement, surgical debridement, these must be mentioned in the case sheet. Why I am saying case sheet is because that means it is registered in our mind that these are the things should be done first before you rush in to do any surgery for the patient. So please understand, without all this, any surgery will fail unless you have this strong basement of medical management in pressure sores. No surgical management will succeed. So how do we prevent pressure? Preventing pressure, now we need to understand, first you have to ask the patient to have individual movement. You tell the patient, please keep moving this side and that side. Obviously, some of the patients cannot do it. Most of the patients cannot do it. Those patients who will be able to move, you tell them to move, it will relieve the pressure to a very great extent. For patients who cannot move, we need to follow the principle of repositioning. That is, you keep changing the position. You are changing the position, but what about the surface on which the patients are lying down? The positions that are good are 30 degree tilted side lying position is a method of placing the patient so that they're tilted 30 degrees and their vertical axis from the supine position. So they are only at 30 degrees. The gravity effect is not much. I told you that the gravity that is acting on the skeletal system and the skin is attached, is stuck to the bed, and the gravity is acting, this causes a shear. To prevent this, it is only at 30 degrees, so the gravity is not much effective there. So there is not much of shear. So the chance of pressure ulcer developing is less. Whereas one of the bad positions is 90 degrees side lying or the semi-recumbent position. This is typical. In all ICUs, the semi-recumbent position is what is very bad. Are best avoided because these increase the pressure over the trochanteric and sacral bony prominences respectively. The position, the 90-degree side lying or the semi-recumbent position. Now, as far as the surface on which the patient is lying, we also have to advise them. Just putting on the ordinary mattress is going to, we know that it is not good. So what do we put them on? So there are two types of surfaces. One is called the reactive support surfaces. The second is called the active support surfaces. The reactive support surfaces are, they react to the body weight. So pressure redistribution of reactive support surfaces are by immersion and envelopment. That is, immersion develops refers to the ability of a support surface to allow the patient to sink into it. As the body sinks in, more of the body comes into contact with the support surface. And we spoke about it in the beginning that when more of the body comes into contact with the support, the pressure is distributed over a larger area and there is a lesser chance of a pressure ulcer developing. So the patient's weight is distributed over a larger area and pressure is reduced. So that is immersion and envelopment. Immersion refers to the ability of a support, that is the patient can sink into it. Whereas envelopment is how well a support surface molds to the body contours and accommodates irregular areas. For instance, if you're going to put a tight sheet on the patient, the sheet is very tight. So the patient, what happens when the patient lies down, it does not come into contact with the entire, because it is so tight, okay? Because it's so tight, certain bony prominences alone are in contact, so the chances of ulcers developing are more. So the reactive surface must be such that it totally envelops and allows a good contact. It allows the surface to mold to the body contours and accommodates irregular areas. you would have noticed that when you have a sheet, ordinary cloth sheet, and there are folds in the cloth sheet, you will note that ulcer formation is much higher because these sheets do not mold into the surfaces and cause ulceration. So this is immersion. It goes into the surface. This is envelopment totally. So this is partial immersion with envelopment. So remember, immersion and envelopment are good tissues. So you have a reactive surface and active support surface. So we have seen reactive support surfaces. We'll see what the reactive support surfaces are. We'll see what the active support surfaces are. The first reactive supportive support surface is foam. This is what we all use. We used to use cotton. It used to be cotton in those days. Now it is foam mattresses. The basic foam mattresses are those composed of different layers of different densities of foam or viscoelastic foam, which are quite good actually. But what happens is foam degrades and loses its stiffness over time, thereby losing its ability to conform. When a foam mattress wears out, the patient may bottom out. You would have seen in different places when the beds are very old, what happens is the bed is in this shape in the center of the bed. So that portion, the foam has sort of degraded, so it bottoms out. So when the patient is supposedly lying on that foam mattress, his sacral region is actually lying straight on the underlying springs and or the metal surface of the bed. So obviously it will not work. Foam can be used, but it must be replaced very frequently. Only then it will be effective. The second sort of reactive support surface is air, or we call it the air bed, air or gel filled mattresses. Now these support surfaces comprise air or gel filled columns or compartments, and air filled support surfaces are sometimes referred to as low air loss surfaces. We talk about air bed, isn't it? Now these are air bed or gel filled also you can have, and these also can be a reactive support surface. They just respond. When the patient lies on it, it only responds. It doesn't do anything. The third reactive supports, there are three main types of reactive support surfaces: foam, and then air filled or gel filled, and air fluidized mattresses. Air fluidized support surfaces provide the greatest immersion envelopment of the support surfaces. Almost 2/3 of the body can be immersed, and an air fluidized support surface comprises silicone or glass beads. So this is the third type of reactive support surface. Now we come to the active support. You would have seen this in some hospitals. They have the alternating cells. It moves like that. So the air moves between two columns. So this support surface is doing something actively. That's why it's called an active support surface. Here there is alternating pressure. The surfaces redistribute pressure by cyclically inflating and deflating zones of the surface. The only disadvantage with this active support surface is that it is sometimes irritating when the patient, when it keeps moving. Second is the sound caused by the electrical power that is causing. And this itself, the movement, inflation and deflation also causes a movement that is sometimes not appreciated by the patient. So now we have taken care of the pressure. We have given a good mattress. We have given an active or a reactive skin mattress that is being provided. Now we need to take care of the skin. We need to assess. We know that if it is too moist, it's going to be bad. If it is going to be too dry also, it's going to be bad. So we need to assess the patient's skin daily, and then we need to cleanse the skin when indicated using a pH balanced cleanser. Remember, urine contamination may cause it to become alkaline. So you need to use a pH balanced cleanser. We avoid soap and hot water. This is a common problem, you know, using soap. Soap dries the skin, which is not good. Avoid friction and scrubbing, and minimize exposure to moisture. Use a skin barrier product to protect vulnerable skin. And emollients should be used to maintain skin hydration. The only thing I have seen in the hospitals sometimes when they keep applying powder, talcum powder to the sacral area, the whole area smells of talcum powder. So the next, and nutrition. We need to take care of the serum albumin must be maintained above 2 grams per deciliter. Also, adequate supply of micronutrients must be ensured. When you write down the instructions in the case sheet, you must, if there is a nutritionist who is attached to your hospital or whose services can be brought, you must involve the nutritionist to improve the nutritional status. Otherwise, our treatment will not work. There is a requirement of 1.5 to 3 grams per kilogram per day of protein to restore the lost lean body mass, and 25 to 30 calories per kilogram of non-protein calories should be delivered daily. Okay, now how do we take care of that? Now we have seen the staging of the ulcer, of the pressure ulcer. How do we take care of the wound in the different stages? In stage one, pressure relief with frequent repositioning, appropriate pressure dispersion, and stage two, silver sulfadiazine and impregnated gauze. So the important thing is choose the dressing correctly. If the wound is desiccated, it needs hydration. If the wound has got excess drainage, it needs absorption. If there is going to be a wound with a lot of drainage, it's going to be moist again. You need absorbent. Wound with necrosis needs debridement. Infected wounds needs antimicrobial. Very simple. So we need to remember the wet to moist dressing. You start off with a wet dressing, then slowly you bring down the amount of moisture in your dressing, and then you make it a moist dressing. There are debriding dressings. Debriding dressings can be either chemical debridement agents like collagenase, enzymatic debriding substances like papaineuria, and autolytic like hydrocolloids, inner gel, forming an absorbent layer, keeping the wound moist. Antiseptic dressings can be used. Absorbent dressings can be used. And lastly, important is negative pressure wound therapy are ideal for all pressure sores, except if there is frank evidence of osteomyelitis, necrotic tissue. When there is necrotic tissue, there's no point. You need to excise the necrotic tissue, then you can put the patient on a negative pressure wound therapy. If there is suspected malignancy in that area or fistula formation, you cannot do a back therapy. We have already seen this last week when we saw about the color of the wound and what dressing. If it is black eschar, you use hydrogel. If it is yellow, the exudate quantity is measured. If it is small or large, use something that absorbs like alginate. If it is small, you can use a hydrocolloid. If it is a red granulation tissue, you can use a hydrocolloid. Now we come to the surgical management. The principle is excision of the ulcer. This is the most important thing. We don't have to remember all the flaps that are possible. We'll just understand the principles of management. Excision of the ulcer, surrounding scar must be excised, the underlying bursa must be excised, and if there is any soft tissue calcification, that should also be excised. The radical removal of the underlying bone and any heterotopic ossification that has occurred. Then, after removing all this, you need to pad the bone stumps and fill the dead spaces. Resurfacing with large regional pedicled flaps is the secret. And grafting the donor site of the flap if necessary. The temptation to perform a primary closure should be resisted, even if the tissues are seen to reapproximate easily, because by definition, a pressure sore has an absolute tissue deficiency. If there is a tissue deficiency, we're going to close it primarily, 100% it will break down. So definitely no primary. I'll show you an example also. Okay, now what about skin graft? Skin graft can be done if you see healthy granulation, yes, but skin graft will have a lack of bulk and poor durability in the face of pressure and shear, especially if a patient is immobile, has got a spinal injury. Skin grafting will not work. It's a very temporary solution to the problem. And it is used only in a patient where acute illness and immobility will be resolved. Patient can start walking from next week or can start walking from next month. Okay, you can do a skin graft because patient is going to become active and your Braden score will keep increasing after that. And if you're going to do a flap, the flap should be designed as large as possible, placing the suture line away from the area of direct pressure. Secondly, flap design should not violate the adjacent flap territories. The first thing is take a large flap. Second, try to avoid the other flaps. There are always many flaps for a particular defect. If you're going to take one flap, make sure it does not encroach the area of the second flap. Supposing this fails, you need to take that. And you know that it's only the local or regional flaps that form a important part of the treatment. So first is what is known as pseudo tumor excision. You need to go. There is undermining. So you see this ulcer, this ischial pressure sore. You can see the artery for the left inside. It goes for such a distance. So it is packed with dye. Usually we use methylene blue gauze. So that is kept inside. And the mouth of the ulcer is closed. So now you have to excise it like a tumor. See, the incision goes over here without exposing this dye-soaked gauze. So if it is blue, you must not be able to see the blue. You come out like this. Then you cut the bone, superficial portion of the bone, do an osteotomy and then take it out. This is called a pseudo-tumor. It's almost you have converted into a tumor and you have excised the tumor without seeing the internal tissues. So let us try to understand the pseudotumor excision. Now, we have already seen that when there is an ulcer like this, this is the underlying bone. That is the opening there. And from there, you know this tip of the iceberg phenomenon. So this is the raw area. So now what you do, you put your artery forceps inside, you are able to see that, you are able to pack that area with gauze, impregnated with methylene blue, which is an easy blue colored dye. So you pack it in completely, nicely fitting into every single crevice inside, which you're not able to visualize. Then make your incision like that. When you make your incision around it like that, you are able to excise it like a tumor. This is how a pressure ulcer must be excised. So after excising the pressure ulcer, the specimen that you have in your hand, that is after excision, should be something like this. It should contain the portion of the bone. It should contain the gauze that you packed inside, which can be colored gauze. And you might have put a stitch on top of it just to prevent it from running out. And then the skin edge, the scar edge, then the surrounding normal tissues. So this is must be the specimen that you have excised. If you have excised like this, then only you can go for the flap cover. Otherwise, whatever beautiful flap you do will stay for some time. It will break down again because the underlying infection, the underlying osteomyelitis will all add to the problem and lead to a recurrence. So, we'll just see some of the flaps that are done for sacral pressure sore. The commonest flaps for sacral pressure sores are the gluteal flaps, that is using the gluteus maximus. Now this is a type 3 muscle. The blood supply is from the superior inferior gluteal arteries from the internal iliac. In ambulatory patients, you should preserve the origin and insertion of the gluteus maximus because the patient needs to have stability of the hip while walking. So the for sacral pressure sores, the commonest flap is the gluteus flaps. Now look at this. Sorry. Now this is the ulcer. This is the excision done. You can see the packing which has been done inside methylene blue gauze. And this is the marking for making the incision. And this is after this is the resected specimen. Here, two flaps have been marked. Rotation flap, one superiorly and one inferiorly. Both flaps, you can see how beautifully here, you can make out that some part of this flap you have had to graft the donor site. So here, but this is not a very ideal flap because the suture line is coming right in the middle, which can break down again. Okay, it is ideal to have a single flap. I'll show you. So that is a unilateral. You can have a unilateral rotational gluteal musculocutaneous flap. Look at this. So this is a sacral pressure sore. This is for the excision and this is the plan. we have planned a single flap so that the suture line comes away from the area of pressure. So the excision has been done. Now look at the defect. How small the defect was, the ulcer was, and look at the defect now after the excision of the pseudo tumor. Now the flap has been raised, you can make out, and the flap has been rotated and it has been closed primarily. Now this is ideal. So what was small over here after debridement and after the flap cover. Second common is the ischial pressure sore. We can use posterior V-way advancement flap based on the biceps femoris muscle in ambulatory patients and hamstring muscle in spinal cord injury patients. The advantages are the muscle will be able to fill the dead space. So as far as ischial pressure sores, please remember posterior V-way advancement flap. The posterior thigh skin can be transferred based on perforating vessels from a cutaneous branch of the inferior gluteal artery. Now the inferior gluteal artery is an important vessel. The superior S-gap is called the superior gluteal artery perforator flap and the inferior gluteal artery perforator, S-gap and I-gap. The S-gap flap is comfortable for sacral and trochanteric ulcers and the I-gap flap is well suited for ischial pressure sores. So this is the number of flaps that are available for ischial pressure sores. Again, gluteal flaps can be used or posterior gluteal thigh flap can be used. Now look at this, you got an ischial pressure sore here. You can do a flap like this and rotate it. Rotate it like this to cover it. Now look at this, very small ischial pressure sores, right? Now the debridement has been done and the osteectomy has been done. Now, how is it going to be closed? Now look at this, there is a temptation for primary closure. This primary closure was not done, but it was just closed before we did the debridement. So this should not be done. And then the flap cover was given for these patients. This is based on the inferior gluteal artery perforator and a transposition flap was done. And here a rotation flap was done. Here you can make out this flap is raised and transposed into the defect like this. Here a rotation flap is rotated into the defect. So you're able to get a closure of both defects. Now this is a VY advancement flap. Now when you have a defect over here, a VY is made. This a V flap on the skin is made. Underlying muscle is also taken, either the hamstring or the biceps femoris. The hamstring is taken and this is totally moved, advanced, so that it goes into the defect. This is the tumor, pseudo tumor excision. Can you make out the gauze with methylene blue? And then, so here you can make out the VY advancement, very little advancement here, but the muscle will go and fill up that defect over here. You can make out a defect over here. Sometimes you can even do a free flap. Now this was a recalcitrant ischial pressure sore for which we did a free LD muscle flap. We had to do a large excision. It almost went up to the anal wall. So we had to debride it and then we had to give a LD muscle flap. Trochanteric pressure sores, on the other hand, the commonest method of treatment of trochanteric pressure sore is the tensor fascia lata, which could be muscle, skin and muscle, or used as an island flap or a free flap. Now there are some extreme procedures called like girdle stone arthroplasty, hemipelvectomy, hemicorporectomy. There are patients who have got totally, their body is riddled with pressure sores because of no sensation. So these patients, these sort of procedures, for instance, this is a girdle stone arthroplasty where they complete, see now this portion is caused, this got ulcers over here. So what happens is not healing at all. So you have to remove the greater trochanter. If you're going to remove the greater trochanter and the ischial region, the femur is gone. So that is completely removed and the vastus lateralis is packed inside and closed. So this is called the girdle stone arthroplasty. These are all extreme procedures which are done in intractable cases. Hemicorporectomy, the lower part of the body is completely removed. See one lower limb and the other side, the thigh skin is completely taken. You can make out the thigh skin taken over here and you can make out even the intestines have become exposed over here. This is used to cover the defect. A stoma is created, colostomy is created, and these are closed. So the entire lower part of the body is excised. So please remember, pressure source can be so intractable. And if we follow the principles, if we follow the principles of management, you understand what causes pressure source. Rather than running to treat the cause, you understand why it has occurred, negate all those factors, you will be able to get a successful treatment of a pressure source. We can have complications after flap. You can have a hematoma formation, you can have a seroma, you can have infection, wound dehiscence, partial flap loss, and recurrence. All these are only complications of the flap. The biggest complication after any pressure ulcer surgery is recurrence of the pressure ulcer, which will not occur if we take care of the underlying factors like nutrition, the surface on which the patient is lying, reduction in the pressure and the shear that we have understood so far, and in getting rid of the infection. So that was about pressure ulcers. Yes. So we'll go to the quiz question of the day before we answer any questions about pressure ulcers. The following are gases used in plastic surgery except argon, helium, copper vapor, excimer. Anybody? Anybody interested? Cosmetic surgery, lasers.
Copper vapor.
Beg your pardon?
Copper vapor.
Copper vapor. Correct. Who is that? I didn't see who that was.
Joseph, sir.
Joseph? Oh, Joseph. Very good. Somebody has answered. Okay. Copper vapor. Ameya has also answered copper vapor. Okay. Right. So now copper vapor is the answer. So just to explain, no? Just to explain the different types of lasers that are used in plastic surgery, you have solid, liquid, and gas lasers. Gas lasers are argon, helium, neon, carbon dioxide laser, and the excimer laser. The solid lasers are the ruby, neodymium YAG, and erbium YAG laser. Copper vapor is a solid laser. And liquids are yellow dye laser and green dye lasers. So the next session will be all about skin grafting, the history, the instruments, the technique, and the aftercare. Very simple. As they used to tell us in those days, if the questioning in your exam is going towards skin grafting, make sure it's almost made sure that you're going to fail, because that is the most difficult thing to answer. About skin grafts. We'll talk all about skin grafts next week's session. Okay. Somebody has asked me a question in the chat box about what are the recent advances in pressure sore. Hitesh Patel. Recent advances in pressure sore management. Apart from the different types of beds that are available, apart from the negative pressure wound therapy that we have seen, there is nothing new. It's all the same thing, because the pressure that is being applied is the same. The only thing maybe is the advancement in the flaps, where you try to give sensate flaps. Even those have not worked, because unless the pressure is relieved, your flap is not going to survive. Only if your flap survives, you can get back sensation there. Because for the sensation to develop in the flap, it will take time. By the time the flap will break down, because unless you take care of the pressure. So I feel that as far as pressure ulcers are concerned, if the basics are not attended to, nothing will work for pressure ulcers. Any other questions? Anybody?
Sir, what about constipation of the patient? Because bowel care has to be taken for these flaps. So how do we constipate these patients? Or what care is to be taken?
No, there is no need for constipation of the patient, because constipation also will not be... See, anything that is unphysiological will lead to problems. So we need to take care of, by taking care of the skin and diverting. Some patients, we have even done a colostomy so that you divert the fecal stream. That can be done. But constipating is difficult because it is unphysiological and patient's excreta will not come out. So you have to allow the fecal matter to come out. But that, either you take care of the of that area after the fecal matter comes out, or you divert the fecal matter through a colostomy. Colostomy can be done to divert the fecal stream so that you do not have contamination of the wound bed.
Sir, one thing also I would like to ask regarding pylonidal sinus infection or pylonidal abscess. We deal with the same area, and here in bed sore also we deal with the same area. So does the principle of management remains the same?
Yes, there is one important difference between the two, Dr. Anjali. The thing is, in the bed sore, the reason why the patient's got a bed sore is most probably because there is no sensation. But in a pylonidal sinus, the area is sensitive. That is one important thing. So even if he lies down over, as you know, the treatment of pylonidal sinus, you have to go right inside, excise it completely and give a flap cover. If you excise it completely and close it primarily, definitely it will break down. Okay. So you have to give a flap cover so that you give adequate padding. See, the basic principle is the same. There is a bone underneath. You have to give a good padding. You have to give a sensate skin. That is possible if you do a rotation flap or a rhomboid flap or a Limburg flap to cover that area. These patients have got sensation. So they will keep moving on their own. Whereas a patient with a pressure sore, he will not be able to move. So that is one big difference between the two. Even though, as you say, the area is the same surgery, the same suture line is there, but still, and the same infection is there almost, but there is a big difference. For instance, there are some patients who have had some injury who were, for instance, patients with a loss of consciousness following a road traffic accident. They have been hospitalized. They were lying unconscious for about, say, 1 month. After 1 month, they have started regaining all the power. They have started walking. They will have a pressure sore. For those patients, now they have become sensate. So nothing will happen. You just allow it with dressings, it will heal most of the time. Even if it does not heal, you can put a skin graft, it will heal. So we need to understand what is the basis. So that is exactly what I'm saying. We need to understand what is the basis, why that particular infection is there in that area. Is it due to a pressure sore? Is it due to a pylonidal sinus? Is the patient, is that area sensate or not sensate? Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening.
Sir, what bed you will prefer, sir? Either air bed or water bed? We are confused with that.
Yes, air bed is ideal. Whatever, even if the air bed is applied, even the small leak is there, the pressure will not be equal. I told you, the patient, it must envelop the patient's body correctly. If it is a fresh air bed, yes. But if the air bed is quite old, then it may not be effective. You have seen those alternating, it's called the alpha bed, isn't it? You can see the alternating current. That is ideal. But again, with all these, you still have to keep changing the position of the patient, because these patients, you can't just put them on alpha bed and forget about them. You have to change the position also. So alpha bed is the best. Second is air bed. If you have a foam bed also, it is good, but do not apply any sheet on it. If you apply a sheet on it, even a small fold in the sheet will cause the pressure will be more in that particular area. And secondly, if there is a lot of moisture, it will stick. Whereas the other beds will not stick to the patient's surface, skin. So alpha bed is best. Air bed is second best. Foam bed, if it is a new bed, it is ideal. But we must remember that the sheet must be clean and dry every time. And emollients must be applied on the skin. It is not enough if the sheets alone are dry. The skin also must be kept moist with an emollient.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, any role of the hair dryer?
Beg your pardon?
Any role of hair dryer in drying of the dressing? hair dryers or
what dressing you want to dry with the hair dryer. Usually, you know, we use a collagen. When you apply collagen on birds, we use the hair dryer. But use of hair dryer, we should be very careful. We have used it sometimes, but what happens is the heat that it causes can be damaging also. It dries up. Okay. What dressing actually you have in mind when you ask the question?
Regarding grade 1 or stage 1, where we apply collagen.
Yeah, correct. When you apply collagen over there, yes, you can apply, but you have to be a little careful because the skin is very sensitive over there. And applying a hair, have you felt the heat of the hair dryer? It may be normal. I mean, it is quite, we are able to bear it. We have normal sensation. But those patients who have a problem, we should be very careful. You know, it's like a patient with a median nerve palsy who has lost a sensation on the hand. Now, if he goes and holds a normal teacup of hot tea, he will develop a trophic ulcer, isn't it?
Right.
So that way, these patients have got a loss of sensation. So be very careful. Even this hair dryer that is being applied, that temperature rise may cause a problem. It is good what you're saying, but you have to be really careful about it. You've all seen pressure ulcers, isn't it? So now I think the way that you look at these pressure ulcers will be different after today's discussion.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Kiran. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Any more questions from the audience? Because it'll be a long week before you see him again. One long week. How is the other program getting along, sir?
Other program is going beautifully, sir. Dr. Sridhar is coming tomorrow as one of the moderators tomorrow. Okay. I'll put up that thing in LGS also, because tomorrow it's about two important aspects. One is about breast reconstructive surgery. After cancer, and the second talk is about virtual planning for mandible reconstruction. How to do a 3D planning?
Okay. Wonderful. Nice, sir. Have a nice weekend.
Thank you. Bye.